that all work of a pioneering and experimental nature has always its own special risks. Many have been the casualties of science, and particularly of medical science, in the early days of modern medicine and surgery. But this never deterred the sincere investigator or slackened the growth of knowledge. In these days of pioneering in the field of occult healing, the same courage must be shown and the same risks assumed. The safeguard from the strictly legal and human angle will be that the patient will be in the hands of a reputable physician for diagnosis and medical care during the time that the occult healer is endeavoring to be of vital helpfulness. The work of the healer and of the healing groups will therefore be supplementary to the orthodox care. Results will have to be carefully watched and noted on both sides. Any group which is formed for healing should work under certain determined policies, and here are a few which I would suggest as essential to success in this transitional period. 1. The patient to be healed or helped, if healing is not possible, should always be in the hands of a good and reputable doctor, and if not, should be encouraged to consult one. 2. The nature of the disease should be known to the group, and should be determined by careful, orthodox medical diagnosis. Copyright 1998 Lucis Trust. 169. A Treatise on the Seven Rays. Volume 4. Esoteric Healing. 3. The age of the patient, his birth date and some information anent his circumstances should also be known, so as to provide a focal point of interest, and a magnetic area should be constructed around the patient which will attract the thought-directed energy of the group. 4. The healer or the healing group should have a general grasp of the nature and the anatomy of the body, the placement of the various organs in the body and the position and nature of the centers governing the diseased area or areas. Charts giving this information should be studied. 5. The faculty of imagination and the power of visualization should be emphasized in a healing group, and the ability should be developed to send streams of energy to the patient and to the area in the patient's body where the trouble lies. 6. The healer or the healing group must remember that it is not mental energy only with which he works. He, for himself, A. creates a thought of healing power. B. That created focal point of concentrated attention becomes the directing agent for the healing force or prana. C. This prana is neither mental nor astral in nature. It is pure planetary substance or living essence, and is that substance of which the vital body of the planet is made. D. The healer or the healing group appropriates as much of this substance as is possible, and by the power of their united thought they direct it to and through the center involved. Healing work is circulatory, and this must not be forgotten. The pranic energy thought directed is not sent to the center and then permitted to accumulate. It is passed through the center, first of all to the organ involved or the area where difficulty is to be found, and then is sent out to the body as a totality. It might be regarded as a system of flushing, with a purificatory and stimulating effect. It is only possible in these early days of experiment and work along these lines to give certain simple rules. Out of the results achieved, experience will come, and the healing group will learn gradually how to work, when to change its methods, and what to notice. From the start of work along these lines, records should be kept. In this aspect of the work, the patient will frequently cooperate. Dates, incidental phenomena, changes for the better or the worse. increment of vitality, as today is little known as the science of modern medicine was known in the year 1200 AD, we will be enabled to work without discouragement and without that undue expectation which today handicaps the neophyte. Assume consciously the position that nothing is as yet really known, and at the centers, the areas of energy in the body, and thought direction, realize also that you are engaging upon a great research project. Nothing, literally nothing, has been done in relation to medicine and the science of the centers in any practical way, though certain books upon the relation of the centers to psychological research and equipment and the glandular or endocrine system have played tentatively with the subject. The field of research which I propose to you is an entirely new one. Those among you who enter it may not see the results of what you are attempting to do. Your impatience and your eagerness to help may handicap you, your ignorance may cause you to make mistakes. Studied, perhaps without realizing its implications, our first point under this heading. This can added to the previous categories of karmic responsibility. Later still, karma in the three worlds is met, overcome and negated, at the same time karma connected with the initiating of causes through world service is added to that which the individual has already experienced, and he shares in the karmic responsibility of the hierarchy itself. All these stages. 1. Elementary group karma, of the primitive man. 2. Individual karma of the self-conscious developing man. 3. Karma, related to the life of the disciple. 4. Hierarchical karma must be added to the well-known karma of retribution with which the disciple is already familiar. 2. It must also be added national and racial karma, plus the educational karma which all disciples bring upon themselves when they are desirous of entering an ashram to prepare for initiation. There is also the karma of reward in contradistinction to that of retribution. This is a type of karma oft forgotten, but one which will become better known in the coming world cycle. Humanity has worked off much evil karma, and the karma based on causes later to be initiated will not generate such dire effects as that of the past. Not all karma is bad, in spite of what man thinks. Much of it is necessarily punitive and distressing, owing to humanity's ignorance and low stage of development. When karmic retribution becomes acute and terrible, as it is in today's appalling world experience, it indicates that humanity has reached a point where consequences can be meted out on a large scale and with justice. Very little suffering is attached to karma where there is ignorance, leading to irresponsibility and complete lack of thought, and there is attached to affairs but little true sense of guilt. There may be unhappy conditions and distressing circumstances, but the ability to respond to such conditions with commensurate pain is lacking. Copyright 1998 Lucas Trust. 172. A Treatise on the Seven Rays.